And so we are in Ephesians chapter 6, looking at the conclusion of spiritual warfare, the subject of spiritual warfare, which we've been on for quite some time. And a good reminder to me as we were studying through, because it seems spiritual warfare seems even more intense than ever with all that's going on in our society. Pretty crazy in our world, I should say. But we're in Ephesians chapter 6 again. And I want to read these verses again. After today, we'll be moving on to finish Ephesians 6. But let's look once again for like the 11th time. Let's stand together and look at Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, and against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, above all taking the shield of faith, and with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Lord, once again, we thank you for your word that speaks to our hearts, and we just ask that you bless this time that we have again. We just want to thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for teaching us and for encouraging us and comforting us in the things that we go through. And we want to thank you that you're previous to every situation, Lord, that brings us great sense of security. So just bless this time we have now in your word. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. You can all be seated. And so the title of the message is Surprise Attack. And someone said when I said that surprise attack, they said, you mean a never-ending attack, you know? And because it is that spiritual warfare that continues for sure. But today will be a summary conclusion that comes with a challenge added to it. So we have been studying this subject of spiritual warfare for some time, and I think it's safe to say that we've gone in depth in Ephesians 6, 10 through 18, and I know each study has had related biblical references that we made to the Old Testament as well as to the New Testament, which helps us to understand this important subject. But although we have spent a great deal of time on this subject, there is no doubt much more that could be said. And I think that the advanced course is when you're engaged in warfare. That's when you get the advanced course. And those of you that have walked with the Lord for very, very long time, you know what I'm talking about. But getting back to the basics is always a really good thing. But I want to recommend that since repetition is a great teacher, that you would set aside some time to revisit the studies, not only as a reminder, but because you would be looking at them one after the other, it would bring cohesiveness to the studies rather than being separated by weeks and months as they have been. But giving that whole picture in just a short period of time, because it seems that the studies can get disjointed when they're separated by that much time. But I believe if you do that, that it will help immensely. And so they're all online, and so you can do that pretty easily. So I recommend that. But just a summary conclusion. In study number one of the study of spiritual warfare, the title of the message was, "We Are in a Battle." And that was study number one on May 15th is when we started that. And from verse 10. The main thought there is that we would be wrong to think that being clueless in the battle, or being clueless in the battle, is dangerous, because if we are, the devil would have been successful in deceiving you. And so we kind of centered around that a little bit. And then study number two, the title Affirmative Action, it requires, coming from verse 11 there, it requires choosing to stand in the battle. You notice there it says to stand against the wiles of the devil. And so we first have to acknowledge that there is a battle, and not to live in denial, but to choose to stand firm in the battle. And then in number three, the title on high alert, we see there in verses 12 and 13, where it's speaking of the enemy that we're against. It's not being a casual bystander, rather it's being all in the battle against that spiritual enemy that we're challenged to step up, to step it up in the battle. Study number four, the belt of truth, is the title there from verse 14. And if we're to ignore truth, we will be living a lie. We are to stand in the truth. The integrity assigned or attached to a genuine believer is to stand in truth. And when we do, we expose the lie. And so our lives are supposed to take a stand with having been wearing the belt of truth. Number five, also from verse 14, there the title, the breastplate of righteousness. And so our spiritual lives are earmarked by living separated unto the Lord. And so we live in the world, but we're not part of the world, but we do live in the world. But we will never be perfect. We've gone over that several times, but we're to live separate from the world. And we can live righteously for the Lord because Jesus is perfectly righteous, and from him we get all the benefits of living in perfect righteousness. It's not because we are perfect, but he is perfect. And because of that, we get the benefits associated with his righteousness. And then in verse 15, study number six, wearing the gospel cleats. And so we need to represent the gospel in word and deed. And so when we do, we have that supernatural traction in everyday spiritual battle. And so it has all to do with picking up our cross daily and following the Lord. And so that's in verse 15. And then we have in verse 16, study number seven, taking the shield, or to take the shield. And so that's the part of the armor that, you know, you're holding on to. And it enables us to ward off the lies of the enemy. Because he will come, and he will come to lie to you. He'll come to condemn you. But because you know God's word by faith, you can stand on his promises. My faith is established not by my feelings, but by what I know God's word says to me. And so when he comes to condemn me, I will even add to his content, if you will. You know, you're guilty of this and you're guilty of that and you did this and how dare you? And I'll say, you know what? But yeah, you're leaving out all this too that I'm forgiven for because I have come to Jesus Christ and he has forgiven me. And so that's all part of the devil's schemes as he comes against us. And so you see that verse 16. Then verse 17, study number 8, we have the helmet of salvation. So our minds, our way of thinking, is well protected by the truth revealed to us in the scriptures, God's word that keeps us away from being confused. And it's a defense against wrong conclusions. And we're not trying to reinvent the world, the wheel of life, you might say. But when it comes to hearing from the Lord, we avoid misstepping. Not, again, not being perfect, but it keeps us really going the right direction. And so having the helmet of salvation. And then also in that verse 17, study number 9, was the sword of the Spirit. Simply is the application of God's word in the battle, and what follows is we can move forward and take ground and make a difference. I thought of David after repentance and getting right with the Lord. He says this in Psalm 51, where he says, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me by your generous spirit, then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall be converted to you." And so here, when we're in step with the Lord, we're going to make a difference in the lives of others when we're walking right with him, and then wielding the sword of the Spirit. And then that study number 10, talking to the Lord, verse 18. And here is where we get our intel. You might say, often our daily assignments as we're in prayer, hearing from the Lord. And there we're also able to air our concerns, because we all have them, things that we struggle with and so forth. And again, I mentioned that that's another offensive weapon, prayer. The sword of the Spirit, certainly an offensive weapon, but also, prayer is like mortars that we fire at the enemy, you know, and fire for effect as we trust the Lord and we pray and so forth. And it says there in verse 18, we're to persevere, you know, to be watchful to this end with all perseverance. We're to endure, to push forward, to move forward. And you know, in doing that, it's all in relationship to the warfare that we're in. And we have fellow warriors, soldiers that are in the battle with us that, you know, we need one another. We covet one another's prayers. We are there to fellowship and encourage one another. Who doesn't need that? And we all need that. And so it's very, very important. I thought about persevering when on Monday we get a call, and Jake's back there. He was successfully bow hunted and got an elk. Happened to be a big elk, like 2 miles back from the road over blowdowns. And we got a call. Well, we finally got down to the downed elk at dark and joined him. He already take a trip out. But it was Sean and Rick and myself and Rick's brother and Jake. So there was 5 of us. And we got there and we all had our headlamps on and boned the elk out and divided it in 5 ways. Like I said, Jake already took a big part of it out. But it was a nice herd bull, a 5x6. And so it was heavy. And so we divided it all out. Now, we were tired. I was tired. I think I speak for all of us. I was tired when I got to the elk. And it was crazy. But anyway, but then we had to carry the elk back out 2 miles. It was 5 miles round trip because you don't go straight. You know, it's like this way all the way down. Anyway, so I remember the last 30 minutes thinking like, I'm done, but I can't stop. You ever feel that way? I'm done, but I can't stop. And I said, leg, go over that next log. Leg, I said, go over that next log, you know. And it was pretty intense, but I just thought, you know what? All along there, if any one of us would have stopped, all of us would have stopped. And if one of us got hurt, elk meat would have just been discarded, and it would have all been about helping the person hurt, not the elk meat anymore. So, you know, we're to persevere with the right reasons. What's the reasons we're persevering, you know, and continuing on? In that same like manner, you know, we're to be considerate that we're in a battle and the enemy is trying to take us out. And so we need to encourage one another and be there for one another. It's important. It's huge, actually. You might say, to me, Pastor, it seems a little extreme, this lengthy study. Well, my experience is this is how I learn. Sometimes I think being a good pastor or an effective pastor, you might say, is kind of like being like a drill sergeant. And I think that, you know, I'm certainly not here to tickle your ears. I'm not here to please you. I'm here to please the Lord. And like a drill sergeant, he knows that his student soldiers are going into a battle. They'll be facing the enemy. And, you know, they usually have bad raps, drill sergeants. Oh, they're so mean, so stern. I mean, think about the pressure upon them. They're taking 18, 19-year-old kids, really, and they're preparing them in, what, 3 months or so? I don't know what that basic training is. I always think of Vietnam as one place. And in 3 months, they're sending them off into the jungles of Vietnam to fight a war, as an example. Can you imagine the pressures on that drill sergeant to think, I have got to download into these kids everything I can, and we can't mess around. You know, there's no sleeping in. There's no slothfulness. And so, of course, they're going to be who they are. They take what they do seriously. So his methods, of course, of teaching would be pour all that he can into them, knowing he just has a short period of time. It makes sense to me. It was Thomas Edison who invented the light bulb, right? An incredible invention, of course. But he attempted, if my memory serves me correct, 1,500 times in different ways to try and make that light bulb. When someone said, you failed 1,500 times. And his response was, no, I didn't fail. I learned 1,500 ways not to make a light bulb. And that's the way to think. And I thought, wow, who thinks like that? Well, I'll tell you who does. One who is determined to accomplish a task, one who is confident that he's going to accomplish a task, and he's aggressive. He's in hot pursuit, and he's on point. I think of 2 Timothy 2:22, flee also youthful lust, but pursue. That means in hot pursuit, not casual pursuit. Pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart, with those. A camaraderie in the hot pursuit of those things. It means to pursue, to run swiftly, to press on, to seek eagerly and earnestly. You think about that, you know, how many times would you have attempted to make that light bulb? 2 times, 3 times, a dozen times, maybe 100 times before you gave up? Would you go 1,500 times? And then accomplish the task? Wow. Jesus said in Revelation chapter 3, to the faithful church, the church that had a little bit of strength, he says, because you have kept my command to persevere, so it's a command, not a suggestion, to persevere, to keep on keeping on, I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. So we're to endure, the word persevere, patiently waiting upon the Lord to continue no matter what is what the word is. Never throwing in the towel, you know, if the manager of a boxer is watching the match and is just going, I can't take it anymore. He's getting brutalized and he throws in the towel for him. No. It can get brutal, this spiritual warfare. But we don't give up. You know, we don't throw in the towel, if you will. And we continue to be here for one another. And can I stress again as a reminder that the enemy, the devil, has a whole army of like-minded evil spirits out to deceive you. They are dedicated to destroying you. They are creative in subtle ways and in obvious ways. Behind the scenes and in full view. That's the wiles of the devil mentioned there in verse 11. And time would fail us to consider the many ways, even categorically, time would not permit the many ways and the schemes and the plans that the enemy comes up with against believers, but here's one, and I think he's getting away with this often, too often, and in a big way. He can to convince you and me that we should live a life of comfort and ease. And I know being Americans, he's got a mindset that leans that way anyway. But to say, you deserve it, you know, that comfort and ease, you know, you deserve it. You earned it. You worked hard. You need now just to kick back and relax. And that's how he begins. And if you lean that way, beware. The Bible teaches us it's never about us. It's always and exclusively living to please Jesus. Not ourselves, although the way it goes when we live to please Jesus, we serve others, and we end up the biggest recipients of blessing. It's the way it works out. It's amazing. And I hope that I don't have to mention again, once again, that the subject this morning is spiritual warfare. Keep that front and center. I watch and see those that, let's say, go the way of least resistance for themselves. I see it all the time. The result is they are lulled into a lethargic state. And that's not healthy spiritually. So Christians, beware that we do not serve the God of convenience. Certain amount of leisure is necessary and good, for sure. No argument there. But not when living for yourself is your way of life. That's dangerous. That runs contrary to fighting the good fight of faith that Paul writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, where he says to Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. Well, living a life of leisure certainly runs contrary to the meaning of that. And idols are consistently knocking on the door of your heart. They do mine. Because it's a battle. It tells us regarding idols, Psalm 115, where it says, but our God is in heaven. He does whatever he pleases. Their idols, the world's idols, are silver and gold, the work of men's hands. They have mouths, but they do not speak. Eyes they have, but they do not see. They have ears, but they do not hear. Noses they have, but they do not smell. They have hands, but they do not handle. Feet they have, but they do not walk, nor do they mutter through their throat. Those who make them are like them, so is everyone who trusts in them. So those who do not trust in the one true and living God will trust in idols. That's the two choices. But the world's counsel is like that. They try and reinvent the wheel of life rather than we have the inventor, the creator of life that has given us his counsel. But the enemy combatants come in many forms: animal, mineral, technological, material, experiential, spiritual, emotional, philosophical, and add to that list. But yet God's word keeps us from going down the wrong path. And only his word. He's a living word, and by the Holy Spirit, then we have direction. Comfort zone, selfishness, leisure living, and convenience are words and concepts foreign to living as a spirit-filled believer. Speaking of when that's a way of life. Beware, be careful. Jesus has this to say to get our attention. Hard one to understand unless you consider it in the light of the context and where he says it in Matthew chapter 10. Do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. So you think that, wait a minute, I thought he's the Prince of Peace. He did not come to bring peace on earth. He came to bring peace to the human soul. That a man could have peace with him. That's why Jesus came. He came to die to save all those who would believe from certain death. And he's the giver of and the promise of eternal life to us. And he didn't come to make peace on earth. And it says, therefore, I have come to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Now that would be speaking of those hostile to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And a man's enemies will be those of his own household. He who loves father or mother more than me, in other words, God taking a second rate, God is second rate according to, those who would love father or mother more, is not worthy of me, and he who loves son or daughter more than me, not worthy of me, and he who does not take his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. Remember, that's a command we all have there. He who finds his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it. And so those who choose to live for Jesus there versus those who choose to live for the world. That's the contrast. choose to love others or the world more than God, or those who choose to love God more than others in the world. That's the context. And here's the deal. Not to understand that, you're set up for a fall in the spiritual battle at hand. The Apostle Paul, he wrote this, things that he learned, because this walk is a process for sure. We're learning things. We're not held all accountable right away for all things. You know, we learn these things, then we're held accountable for what the Lord shows us. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly, Philippians 4, that now at last your care for me has flourished again, though you surely did care, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Very important information there. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so we see there God's approval or endorsement of him had no bearing on the experiences of his life, whether negative or positive. No, it's all according to God's plan, God's will. Can be extremes. You know, that gets back to Psalms 115:3. It says, but our God is in heaven and he does whatever he pleases. And we have to know that to be true, whether abased or abounding. Whether abased, trusting in the Lord for the trial. Whether abounding, resisting the temptations in that place of abounding. But Paul also wrote to Timothy just before he was about to depart this earth. He wrote to Timothy, leaving some final words to Timothy. For I am already being poured out. Paul knew he was about to be martyred. He's all in. I'm about to be poured out as a drink offering. The time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. And so he's speaking of not that as a day of doom and gloom, but a day of glory. That's what he's speaking about. I finished my race. I'm about to be martyred. You know, be like you on death row for serving Jesus Christ. I'm about to, you know, have a lethal injection here to meet the Lord, to be rewarded. What? Yeah, that's what the scriptures tell us. Can I remind you that the subject this morning is spiritual warfare? And he gave an example also of the list of things that he had to endure. One that you're familiar with, I'm sure, in 2 Corinthians 11, where he says, are they ministers of Christ? He's dealing with those in Corinth that were boasting their status as godly men who are being blessed by God, and they're very prideful and arrogant, and you know, and meanwhile he's the one that planned the church. He's dealing with that. Give you a little background. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequently, in deaths often from the Jews. Five times I received 40 stripes minus one. Three times I have was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have been in the deep. And so in journeys often, in perils of water. Perils means his life was in danger in all these different ways, that his life was on the line there in waters and perils of robbers and of his own countrymen, mean the Jews, and of the Gentiles, and in the city, and in the wilderness, and in the sea, and in among false brethren, verse 27, in weariness, and toil, and sleeplessness, often in hunger, in thirst, in fastings, often in cold and nakedness. Besides the other things, what comes upon me daily, my deep concern for all the churches. And so spiritual warfare comes in many sizes and shapes. That's why the title of the message this morning is The Surprise of Warfare. You know, surprise of, that's not what I worded it. The surprise attack. The surprise attack. That's it. Because we never know. Surprise. Spiritual warfare. Surprise. And yeah, you know, it's not a surprise when you're focused in and you're expectant. But not all of us are going to be that in tuned all the time. Surprise. Where did this come from? I never expected that or this or whatever comes our way. And you look at that and you read that list, you go, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense. Well, it would make sense unless you're not tracking in the battle. Paul was tracking in the battle. To him, it made perfect sense. First, no, not everything makes sense. Does that make sense? Know that, you know, everything is not going to make sense because we don't know everything, and that's why. But we serve God who does. This is where we get our calmness of heart. What we do know is he has a perfect view of eternity. What we do know is his plan has that factored in the equation. That's the bottom line, is we know that it's his plan. We're part of it. We're not perfect. He is. We may view very difficult things as being wrong. But you know what? When you serve God, they're right. The Apostle Paul wrote, once again, the church of Corinth, where he wrote in 1 Corinthians 4, he's really confronting elitism and those that were gauging God's approval by worldly standards, not the church. They were gauging God's approval, and they were using worldly standards in the church. He says, 1 Corinthians 4, we are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. Sort of sarcasm there. We are weak, but you are strong. You are distinguished, but we are dishonored or despised. Sarcasm. Oh, okay, so you're the ones that have figured out, right? You're the ones that God's called. Not us, you. To the present hour, we both hunger and thirst, and we are poorly clothed and beaten and homeless. And we labor, working with our hands, being reviled. We bless, being persecuted. We endure, being defamed. We entreat. We have been made as the filth of the world, the offscouring of all things until now. And so we're suffering these things, and we serve the Lord. We're the elite, if you will, spiritually, but this is what we have to endure. And so these are those that were boasting that they're the ones that were called, because if it was Paul, why would he be working? Why would he be making tents? Why would he be beaten? Why would he be arrested? Why would all these negative things be coming upon him if he was the called ones? But we're the called ones. You notice, we don't even work. You know, we just kind of hang out and serve the Lord. God has enabled us. We're the special ones. And it's sad. You know, and it's sad that you take within the church the worldly standards to gauge success. It's like, look at the way my pastor dresses. He has obviously a lot of money. You see the car that he drives. And he uses humor so well in the pulpit. And he just has so much charisma. And everybody just loves him so much. And And everything just is so right with my pastor, and, you know, not to say that all those things couldn't be true, but I'm just saying that if that's our standard, because look at that pastor, he's always getting sick, and that pastor, he's having to work a second job so that he can continue to pastor. That pastor, is he really called to be a pastor? How dare people think that way? Look at how big that guy's church is, you know. Look at how small that person's church is. Whose church is it? And so we don't use the world. See, the world's standard of success is like that. When, meanwhile, most of the churches in the world are very small churches that meet together and fellowship together and love one another and are patient, waiting upon the Lord. And guess who's right in the middle of that church? Jesus Christ. How dare that we would take the worldly standard to judge the church? That's what Paul was dealing with. So Paul laid it all out. This is what we deal with. Look at all that Jesus Christ endured. Everybody fled from him because he spoke the truth. They didn't want to be associated with him. Jesus even said to his remaining disciples, "Are you going to leave too?" He didn't come to bring peace to this earth. He came to bring peace to man's soul. The Apostle Paul, he lays it out very clearly. And what we need to walk away with in extreme trials and difficulty is our spiritual dignity. That's what we need to walk away with. Just like Job, in the extreme place where Job was Job 13:15, he said, and he was, this is the most extreme example that I know of. He said, "Though he slay me, I will trust him." And so we need to keep our spiritual dignity, our spiritual confidence, the security of relationship. With the full armor intact. And we know, as the word tells us, God's ways are not always the way we would think or what we would do. You know, and so we need to have that confidence. In Isaiah 55, and last verses here that I'll read, "Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing which I sent it. For you shall go out with joy, be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress tree. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree. And it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off." So the enemy comes. Where is your God in the midst of trial? That's what the enemy would ask. My answer, right where he's always been. He's on the throne, and he's my Lord now and forever. Amen? Amen? Amen. All right, let's stand together. Lord, I want to thank you for your word again and the comfort that we have. Just want to thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness and We just ask that you would continue, Lord, to pour out your Spirit upon us and help us to serve you even when times are difficult. I just pray for all those that are here today, and I just ask, Lord, that they would be equipped by you, Holy Spirit, with that full armor, and that they would keep their eyes upon you, Lord, and that daily picking up our cross and following you and living fully for the day's opportunities that you give us, Lord. And we just pray for the strength to do that. I just pray if any in here, Lord, have just kind of been sidetracked from that, that today their decision would be to follow you wholeheartedly. And so we just ask that you continue to have your way in us and through us, Lord. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your provision. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.